Right, good morning, good evening, good afternoon, whatever it is, wherever you are, I hope you're having a good one. Until a very wet and windy spring here in Wellington. Rather fitting, opening season's a couple of days away, so all the rivers are flooding and making themselves inaccessible. But I figured I'd tie a little pattern called a flimph for you all tonight. It's an emerger. Nice simple pattern, and they're pretty handy. They're somewhere between a soft hackle and a wingless dry fly. You can swing them around. A good one to think about, especially for those of you who are about to head out and hopefully find some clear water. But swung through the water, it's an effective pattern. Chance to demonstrate a couple other ideas as well. This variation of it, we're tying using squirrel tail. In particular, we'll be using the fibres, or the hairs, down the bottom of the tail. I'll go into that as we go on. So they'll make up the tail and the dubbing for the body. For the ribbing, which you can use or don't use, we're using Semperfly Crystal Pearl from the Semperflash range. The thing with these patterns is it's often tied with a lot of translucency, so getting the colour of the thread underneath is a big part of it as well, or if you wanted to, you could put floss underneath. So you don't have to use the ribbing, it does sort of compact the dubbing down just a little bit, and probably loses some of that, but at the same time I like having that little bit of flash running through there. And then for the hackle, we're just using a grizzly cape. I can't remember if it's a hen or a cock. I think it might be a cock given how sharp the tip of the feathers are, but and that's just to give that hackling thread. Semperfly Nano, tried and true, always good. And that's just in a 30 denier. For the hook, I'm using a AREX FW580 in a size 10. Again, bigger, just easier to film, really. But I tie these very little, all the way to about this. But you could probably almost get away with going bigger as well, and they can represent like a fallen terrestrial pattern. But enough yammering on, we'll crack on and get into it. And I hope it's a helpful video. I hope you enjoy it, and we'll give it a nudge. Cheers. Right, as mentioned, this is an AREX FW580. Now, this is a barbed hook, but I just crimped the barb down. I've also got barbless versions, which I think is the 581. Don't quote me on that though, not 100% sure there. It's a wet fly hook. As per every fly, we'll start off putting our thread base down. And we'll just get that on there. Yeah, as I mentioned, one of the traditional aspects of this fly is dubbing it in a way which lets that colour of your thread shine through. So you could also play with different colours of thread, or put a floss base underneath as well if you wanted. Whatever takes your fancy, greens, browns, red. Will's your oyster, just give it a go. Once we've got that in there, we will take our scissors and just get rid of the tag end, and we'll move on to the tail. Alright, as mentioned, we are using a squirrel tail for the tail of our flimph. For these, I use the here you get right down the bottom there. It's got some neat colouring in it, and I also get the dubbing from that. So once you've taken out, or you cut out your little segment that you want to use, and you just pull that straight out from the tail, and you can just cut it off nice and even. A little bit scraggly, and you kind of want that, I think. It just gives it that sort of emergery look. So you get your little bit like that, take it by the tip, and as you pull on it, you'll see all these fibres coming out. And that's just all the under fur. That's going to leave you with your little tail, which we are going to tie in. And take your pick. I like a shorter tail. It's a little bit long. About half to a third the length of the hook shank, probably. Yeah, like that. You can go longer, shorter. End of the day, it's an emerger, so a little bit scruffy, it can work wonders with it. So you'll see the little, a little bit hard, but you can kind of see the little tips flicking out there everywhere. I think it gives it a wonderful look. You don't have to do it like that. You could use pheasant tail, like you would for a PT nymph. Predator fibers, or you could go for something a little bit more straight, like CDL, Croctolion. Or you could combine them, so you got that image of like a more structured tail sticking out and this being all the shuck. But once you got that tied on, we will move on to the rib. Okay, for our rib we're using Crystal Pearl from Semperfly in the Semperflash range. They come in this little pack here, you can kind of see it. Made the mistake before of taking it all out, it ends up a tangled mess. It's fine if you're using it for ribbing, but when it comes to using it for bodies, it can be a bit of a nightmare. So what I'll do, you kind of just see it there, is I'll make a little nick in the side, and then you can pull out a couple fibers or a single fiber at a time. End of the day, if you want more, you can make a bigger nick in it, or you can just open it up. But I like it to add a bit of flash to this pattern. You could use wire as well, which will, I'm just going to get that tied in, which will give it a nice look too, but it'll also give it a bit of weight as well, depending on how thick you go with the wire. But we'll just get that tied in on the side, ready to go, and we'll move on to the dubbing. Right, onto the dubbing. So this here is all the under fur I picked out from that little bit of squirrel tail. We're going to use that to dub our fly. As I mentioned, traditionally with the pattern, they dubbed it sparsely, so you could see the colour underneath. And to do that, you can touch dub. So I will take some wax. Don't know what brand this is. I got it when I first started tying flies 8 odd years ago or something like that. Just run a little bit up and down your thread. It's just going to help it stick. And then just take a little bit of your dubbing. Again, it's always a case of less is more. It's easier to add it than it is to take it away. And then just as the method suggests, you're just touching it on there. You're not really making a, the dubbing noodle as you traditionally would. And just getting it on there nice and loose. As you wrap, it's actually going to clinch down on it anyway, which is going to hold it in place. You'll get bits flying off as you do the rest. And like I said, the ribbing is going to compact it a bit. Which isn't necessarily the original look of it, but I like it. And if we're here, we might as well demonstrate how to do it. If you don't want the dubbing, don't do it, and you end up with a more traditional version. But we'll wrap this around, and you'll see it start to build up there. Again, it's just meant to be quite sparse, and you'll get little bits where it's a bit balder than others. But just keep on going, got plenty of that under fur. And just keep touch dubbing it on there. It's a little bit of a process. And you just gotta roll with it, keep going. And like I said at the start, this is a bit more of a, I don't want to say drab, but brown, boring, but natural too. Now you just want to bring it up until in about 2/3 of the way up, and then we'll move on to the ribbing. Right, as I mentioned, you could skip this step entirely, but for the purpose of demonstration, I'm going to do it. I like the little flash in there. It gives it that, it makes it kind of eye-catching. What the fish see it as, who knows, whether it's just eye-catching, or if it, looks like air bubbles trapped around a merging insect, or if it just helps to replicate that look of movement. But either way, good to have a few. And end of the day, if you don't want the ribbing, skip this step entirely. Yeah, and we'll just tie that in. You just want to evenly space it. And there's still plenty of stuff sticking off it. You'll still have a little bit of translucency, but yeah, at this point I'll just pull everything back as well, just softly get those fibers all out of the way for this next step. Right, next step is the hackle. I usually aim for around about the same length as the hook gap. You can see that when you hold the feather up, it looks roughly right. You could sort of partially wrap it around if you want to test it, or obviously get a hackle gauge. I haven't bothered with one, I just like to eyeball it. Generally ends up all right. Again, just using the grizzly cape. This one's rapidly growing some bald patches, but it does the job. And to prepare it, you can see there's a natural curve in it. I will have that facing away from me. You can see one side's sort of more vibrant than the other there as well. One's a bit dull. So if you have the dull side away from you, and just pull away those bottom fibers and get yourself some stem to use to tie in. And then take that point, or tip, sorry, and we will tie that in. Some people will tie in a bit of a wedge and then just tie that under. I like to give myself plenty to work with. Each their own though. And then we'll just get our scissors underneath there and snip away the tip. Nice and tidy. And then we'll move on to the rest of the dubbing. Alright, for the next part we're going to dub the rest of the hook. Same thing again, just get a bit of wax on there and take a little pinch of your dubbing. Yeah, I feel like I mentioned in most of my videos, adapt it to how you need it. Like, you don't have to use squirrel tail for the dubbing or for the tail. There's a lot of other furs and materials out there. If you wanted to use it, you could, you know, stepping away from the traditional necessarily, but you know, quills and synthetic quills, and you know, you could use all sorts of other critters to dub the body. You know, here obviously being a good one. And then I like to put one just in behind where I've tied the hackle in. I find sometimes if you don't, you end up with a little bit of a gap. In between the feather and the dubbing itself. Sorry, just misplaced my dubbing there. There it is. Grab a little bit more. Don't need much more here, but just a little. You'll notice there's bits and pieces all sort of flicking off everywhere. The other thing as well, like I said in the intro, it's a step between a wingless dry and a nymph or a soft hackle. It's not a big step away to start putting wings on it if you wanted. It's just going to give it another sort of look to it. You know, whether you want to use slip wings or I've used predator fibre in the past, and it just gives it a cool look. Right, we're a bit shaggy here, but it's going to do. At the end of the day, we're going to run the hackle over that. I've got a few fibres sticking out here and there, but I kind of mentioned it, it's an emerger. They can look a bit scruffy, and they fish well. Many times I've found once they've been chewed on a few times by a few fish, they work better. But we'll just get that all ready to go. Let's take our hackle pliers and we're going to start wrapping the hackle here. It's unlike a traditional soft hackle, which starts or wraps the hackle just around the head. This comes or starts further back and builds up through the body. It's still just going to preen those feather fibers back. You're probably going to get 3 or 4 wraps through here. And that's just going to give it a whole nother world of movement. Hopefully look tantalizingly good to whatever you're fishing for, be rainbows, browns, or any other trout species. Once we get to the head, we're just going to tie it in. I'm tying a few of these today and managing to snap the hackle off beforehand. I think I just twisted a little bit too much, so I'm a little bit quite happy to get there first go. We'll just snip away that. Again, we're just going to bring those back a little and just really secure it in. And we'll move on to that whip finish. Alright, whip finish. Figured I'd go through it. So you got the hook one end, and you've got your little notch down that end. So if you pull your thread towards you, and you put your hook over top of the thread, pull it down in front of that little notch, and run it around the back, then back over top of the thread, and get it nice and tight onto the hook shank, and then you can just start wrapping it around. And that'll just twist naturally. You'll find you'll just want to do it as you move it around in a circle. Then once you've done four or five little twists, move it like that, and that notch is going to pop out. Just hold it tight with the hook and then pull it down, and it'll slide out, and you'll be away laughing. There we go. Got a little fibre there, but that's all right. Alright, there we have it, one squirrel tail flimph. Real handy little emerger pattern to have to swing through, and you can tie them bigger or smaller as you see fit. Here being a smaller or slightly smaller version. Handy way to use some of the end of that squirrel tail, especially if you use it more for hair wing patterns, like I've been tying a lot of rat salmon flies for fun, but hopefully I'll fish them. But great way to use the very bottom of that and get rid of some of those smaller fibres that might not necessarily make a great hair wing. We've got the squirrel tail through the body as the dubbing in the tail. We've got that grizzly hackle for the hackle tied on the AREX FW580. You can crush the barb, or you can buy barbless hooks as well. And we've got some of the Semperflash Crystal Pearl as the ribbing, nano silk for tying on. But it's a handy pattern. I hope you've enjoyed it. I hope it works well for your happy tying. Cheers. Take a quick moment to say cheers to Dissolve as well. They've just brought out a whole bunch of new kit for summer. Unfortunately for you people in the Northern Hemisphere, there'll be winter, but cool company based here in Wellington. They do some cool stuff. Really cool designs, both for freshwater and salt. T-shirts, hats, but cheers guys, always appreciated.